is entirely too early in the morning for such cheery musical compositions, and it's like 3 in the afternoon, so that should tell you something. This is LGR Plays, and we're taking a look at Pushcat. Quite the intriguing name, if you ask me. And yeah, I had no idea what to think of that at first. Like, why would you want to push a cat? That seems like it would accomplish nothing but some scratches to the face and some confused feline emotions. But no, this is a cat that pushes things and is purple. I love that name, though. I mean, you could come up with 100 different sequels, like Poke Dog or Slap Horse, Choke Chicken, Spank Monkey. I mean, you could go on and on. This is genius. And who is responsible for this geniusness? Why, none other than Zoot Games, founded and designed, or whatever, by Fritz Solares. Yes, based in Brighton, Southeast England in the UK, and yeah, that guy's name is awesome for a game about cats, I gotta say. It just fits. I used to have a cat named Snickle Fritz, so that's pretty much the first thing that came to mind when I saw his name. But yeah, that aside, it's also got artwork and everything by Gary Luckin, probably better well known as Army of Trolls, responsible for the pixel art awesomeness like Video Game Cities 2.0 and a ton of other stuff, but that's what I knew him for. So yeah, awesome artwork. And what in the frick is the game? Well, it is an indie game that's available only at pushcatgame.com for now, for PC and Mac. Totally DRM-free. Maybe coming to other platforms eventually. That would be cool if it were a little bit successful. Not terribly expensive. It's like £5 or €6 or $8. You get 60 levels and 5 worlds of gaming. I've only unlocked the first couple worlds because it's pretty friggin' challenging and my brain does not quite function in the way that this game requires. What does it require? Well, let's do first dig and you'll see what I mean. So, Pushcat is this. It's Boulder Dash mixed with Bejeweled. That's the easiest way to describe it. Or perhaps Supaplex meets Jewel Quest or whatever. I don't know. You could describe it different ways like that. It's basically match 3. Bink. Like that. Mixed with the digging and puzzle-solving whatnot craziness of games like Boulder Dash. I mean, that's probably what it's most well known as. And Supaplex for you DOS people. Oh, crap. I don't want to do that. No! It's not quite that big of a deal. I am just in a very dramatic mood. Righto. So you can see, you've got the physics thing going on where you can push things and dig and stuff. Crap! And completely screw yourself very, very easily. I am extremely good at that. Dang it! Well, that worked. Yeah. It's not quite the same physics as Boulder Dash. You know, like, if you do this, you're not going to see the stuff that over on the left there fall. So, you don't have that to worry about, but you do have the whole you can't push things upward thing. Like, I can't push that. So, it's not like Sokoban, where you can push things in any direction, or Chips Challenge, whichever. You can't do that. But, what you can do is learn the rules of the game. See, like that right there, that didn't quite, it doesn't have to stop in one place for the jewels to connect. As long as it passes by, then that works. I gotta say, it's quite the intriguing combination of genres, especially if you're a fan of those, and I definitely am. I am more of a fan of them on, well, old school systems and, like, portable systems. So honestly, I would really like to see this come to the Commodore Amiga. So yes, Zoot Games, get working on that, please. Amiga port, ASAP, or Atari ST, that'd be cool. Oh, frick, let's go. Let's just keep on going. Yeah, Sword M5, ZX Spectrum. How about the PDP? PDP-10. Ooh, the Commodore PET. Why not the Thompson M05? Don't leave the French people out. Anyway, I'm serious though. I like this type of game, but you know, on a PC, it's just like there's so many other alternatives of things that I'm just like, yeah, you know, am I really gonna sit down and play this for very much or for very long or whatever? Well, yeah, it's an intriguing concept, that's for sure. So I'm, but past that point of initial intrigue, I'm kind of thinking, I don't know. I guess I'm quick to move on to other things. It's just that I play so many games during a week. I mean, good grief, this is the, what, sixth concurrent game that I am playing through right now? So, yeah, my attention is divided. And for this, there's just so much here as far as levels and varieties of gameplay, really. You're not seeing much here, but I'll show some more. That it seems unfair to just leave it half unfinished. I'm just totally rambling on about personal preferences here, but I feel it's somewhat fair. Since it's a cool game, and I don't mind the more casual games like this, but I prefer them on a mobile platform, or a completely retro one. That music, seriously, is entirely friggin' cheery, and it kinda makes me want to throw up. But, at least it sounds cool. It's got that nice sort of chiptune sort of sound to it. Kinda reminds me of the song Popcorn by Gershon Kingsley. Good old music to Moog by. Yeah, just a little bit. You know, that the sound, not necessarily the composition itself. Although I could deal with some popcorn being in here, you know, then it'd be a little more reminiscent of Digger, the PC, man. Popcorn never stops playing during that friggin' game. Okay, let me explain some of the mechanics here. You probably see that I got that checkpoint for the lock quite a bit ago. But if you want to actually complete the level, you want to make sure that you get all of the silver. So, you know, you get silver by matching the colors. And, yeah, I could leave at any time once you unlock that lock up there, which lets the exit become available. So, if you want to do that, that's fine, but the thing is, yeah, let me just get out of here because I've already unlocked this one. Who cares? You have to get this Dimension X thing or this final cave unlocked before you can unlock other worlds. So what you need to do is, I think you needed 5 stars to unlock this one. So if you don't get the star, which is collecting enough of the silver, not just the minimum amount, but the amount to get a star, you have to get enough stars to unlock this, which is unlocking worlds. So, see, these 4 I kind of skimped out on, and, well, yeah, you can see why I kind of skimped out on this one. You need 200 friggin' silver, and, well, sure, you can definitely pull that off, it looks like. I mean, there's a lot of... There we go. Yeah. But some of them, yeah, it's just, it's really, really challenging. Mainly because I end up blocking myself in somewhere, or I end up pushing so many gems off the side, or, yeah, something crazy like that. I hate myself for about 10 minutes after that, so, yes. Combined with the illogical sadness that I feel from the music of this game, it can be quite depressing. I do like the music, I really do. It's just, it's so happy it hurts. See, I'm doing okay, but like I'm losing so many of these things. Pushing them off the side, and it just gets overwhelming, you know? Largely because I run out of patience, or run out of drinks, or run out of running out of things to run out of. Now I'm gonna push you all away! Ah. Let me show something else here. Yeah, Dimension X. So when you finally do get through all of these and earn enough stars, you'll unlock Dimension X with a disturbing lack of Krang and Shredder. So you have these sort of like a... feels like a bonus stage, really. Talk about satisfying. This is awesome. Still very easy to get yourself screwed. Oddly enough, I'm trying to screw myself at the moment, and it's not working. Okay, here we go. Yeah. You could just be wandering around and be like, ah, crap, can't push anything! And he turns into a cat skull. That cracked me up when I first saw it. It just turned into a skull. It's like... Yes. Cat skull. At 4 in the morning, it's hilarious, trust me. Have I done these? It's new, I guess. I haven't. Minor Combiner. Let's try it out. Oh, my. What is that? Oh! Well, that certainly is intriguing. Alright, so, yeah, this is kind of an example of it. You can see that there is definitely an element of randomness going on here. Not only with these things randomly being tossed out, but every time you start the level, the gems themselves, which colors are where, is going to be different. So there really is no one single way to solve every level. The base layout's going to be the same. Like, obviously those dispensers or whatever they are always going to be there. They're always going to be in the same spot. There's always going to be the same amount of gems the bottom there, but they're going to be different colors, or, you know, the colors are going to be in different spots slightly, so. I wouldn't say it hinders the puzzle-solving aspect of it, but it does make it interesting because, well, walkthroughs kind of are negated because of that. You know, it's not like the puzzle sections in something like, you know, the games like Flux, or I think Bejeweled 2's puzzle section, if I remember correctly. Or even Boulder Dash, really. Where you'd have stuff in exactly the same spot every single time. But, you know, this definitely adds that replayability factor to the game. So, yeah. How many do I need? 160 freaking A! I mean, that's totally doable, but still. This is interesting, though, because you can't move any of these around down here. I really like this. This is quite different from any of the levels that I've played so far, and that's one thing I've been most impressed with, is really just the sheer variety of different ways of playing. Even though it's all the same very basic mechanics going on throughout the entire game, there's a lot of complexity going on here, too. And that's commendable, honestly, because games like Boulder Dash or Repton or any of those, at least the earlier ones, they tended to get a bit boring because of the same old thing going on. I mean, sure, you have, like, enemies and stuff later, but still, a lot of the mechanics remain exactly the same. They just got more challenging because there were more unfair enemies floating around and such. From what I gather, there are definitely unfair enemies later on in this, too, so can't wait for that. I don't know if they're unfair. They probably are. They're always unfair in these games. And by that, I mean they're very fast. Or perhaps slightly annoying. Yes. Okay, I want to at least get the minimum here. And a couple minor things I want to mention. You'll notice that it's not quite fully widescreen. There actually are no resolution options in the game at this point, which that kind of sucks. I would like it to at least fill up my entire screen, whether it's 16:9 or 16:10, but you just can't do it. There's also no way to change the controls, Although, I don't really think you'd need to. You just move around in four directions, and you can use either a keyboard or an Xbox 360 controller or whatever you have plugged in. Ah! I will find a way to lose this puzzle no matter what! Oh, there we go. I think I could really pull off the 160, but I'm gonna do that some other time. I don't want this video to go on forever. I've opened a new cave! Bingo! Snoop drop? Well, that looks thoroughly challenging. Future fives! Let's see. Okay. Yeah, talk about being split up here, because I think I've already made this impossible. Oh, man. Let's see if I restart it. Did that change the colors at all? Well, it looks like the colors are the same on this one, so maybe some of them have different ones, because I know I've restarted a lot of the puzzles and, you know, the colors that the gems are change. They don't appear to be on this one, which makes sense. That one looks like it's one of those that you really have to plan every single move, like, exactly. Alright, here's one. These rainbow blocks are quite interesting. So, what these do, you see all these weird gray things look like, I don't know, Terminator testes or something. If you take... never mind, can't do that. Aha. Yeah. Okay. Here we go. Match three of those, they explode. And then the T-1000 balls turn into coins. That's how you get coins on these. Again, quite an interesting concept. The conversion of obstacles into collectibles. Yes, yes indeed. I have been trapped! No! It's so anticlimactic, he just turns into a skull, that's... Okay. Alright, well, I think that gets the gist of Pushcat. Definitely worth grabbing if you like these kinds of games. You know, the mixture of the Match 3 with the classic Boulder Dash formula, I gotta say, is... You know, why hasn't it been done more often? I don't know. It makes complete and total sense. So, yes, Pushcat. Check it out, and thanks for watching.